they told all their friends about what's happening in the synagogue that past Sabbath. And the next week, almost the entire city gathers together to hear Paul and Barnabas preach the gospel. The Jews were very upset about that. In fact, they'd be jealous about that because they'd worked that city for a long time and they'd never gotten a response like this. And now suddenly there are two outsiders who are coming in. They get a tremendous response, a tremendous revival takes place. Many people are turning to the Lord Jesus Christ. And so they become jealous. They become jealous. Jealous of a good thing. But worse than that, they become envious. They not only want it for themselves, they want to destroy what Paul and Barnabas have done. That's the difference. But we find that we see people who are really jealous and want something that they could have for themselves, and so they work hard to get it. And envious, where they see something someone else has, and they, rather than working hard to get it themselves, they try to destroy what the other person has. Sad, but that's the way people are. I'm sure you're running into folks that are like that. So when they oppose what Paul and Barnabas have said, and actually last week, because of course Paul and Barnabas are presenting Christ, and so by speaking against the Lord Jesus Christ, his death, burial, and resurrection, they are blaspheming the God of Israel. They are blaspheming against the one who has provided salvation. It says, but the Gentiles did respond in a different way. The Gentiles heard this, they were glad and glorified the word of the Lord, and as many as were ordained to eternal life they believed, and the word of the Lord was published throughout all the region. And that brings us to our three verses for tonight. We'll do a quick overview, but let's read these verses so we can see them in this context. But the Jews stirred up the devout and honorable women, and the chief men of the city, and raised persecution against Paul and Barnabas, and expelled them out of their coasts. So they shook off the dust of their feet against them and came unto Iconium. And the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Ghost. Now, Paul and Barnabas had actually been saying a lot of friendly things when they got opposition, you recall. They basically said two different things. They said, you're lost and going to hell. When the Jews opposed them, that was that phrase, you recall. But seeing put it from you, The wives liked it and were also becoming devout and honorable in their actions. These gardeners were starting no longer to take their wives for granted, as in many pagan societies the men do. Suddenly, though, it seemed like their husbands had become fanatics. They're running all over the region, reaching what appears to be a new religion. And that was disconcerting to women who perhaps had always before suffered and now things were getting better, and suddenly things are turning radically again. Now, as I mentioned, I suspect it was a Jewish group, though I cannot prove it, the Jewish women did that in particular synagogue. And I think that perhaps after the explosion in the synagogue, the husbands went home and may have gotten a tongue lashing from the wives, something like this. Why didn't you answer those heretics better? If you're not going to do something about it, I am going to do something about it. So like the old wives say, Monty happened, ain't nobody happy. I suspect something along those lines was going on. How in the world could the honorable women suddenly get so agitated over what Paul and Barnabas had been preaching? Go to a modern synagogue today that has the semblance of a synagogue, not in the reformed tradition necessarily, but in sort of the conservative Orthodox synagogues. The women sit in one section, the men sit in another section. In the more lax synagogues, the women are busy talking to one another while the men are over there reciting their prayers, listening to the canter, doing those sorts of things. And the women don't seem to be a whole lot involved in the services. Well, something happened where this was, and I think it was, the Jewish women in that synagogue. Something happened where they got upset. They suddenly tuned in. They suddenly saw what was going on. They suddenly saw chaos happening in their synagogue. And it did not make them very happy. When women are on crusade, things happen. Women who are on crusade for what they think is righteous are hard to stop because male law enforcement, at least until recently, has always given courtesy deference to ladies. Let me give you some illustrations. Think back to Prohibition. And the axe wielding women who marched into bars and began chopping up the bar with their axes, whacking the tables with axes, whacking the chairs with axes. Very nation. Think about women's suffrage marches, flooded with women who are campaigning for the right to vote. They're on a righteous cause. It's good women. It wasn't the prostitutes who were chopping up the bars. It wasn't the lazy women who didn't care whether they voted or not that were out on the women's suffrage marches. It was righteous women. It was good women who were doing that. Think in more modern times about the masses of women who have been involved with the so-called women's rights marches in Washington in our own day and age. Masses of women who think they're on the path of righteousness and justice are a hard force to stop. They will not be swayed by dispassionate discourse. They will not be pacified by quiet reasoning. They will not negotiate after a period of cooling off. When their anger and emotions are met in full fury, will the man who stands in their path. Well, that's true. It's not criticism of women. God has put it into women so that when they perceive something to be righteous, they're willing to stand up for it even when men don't. And frequently men don't. The problem is not, however, the venom of the righteous anger against unrighteousness, because I think we all should have righteous anger against unrighteousness. The problem is that they and we don't always get it right before we met. That's what happened to Paul and Barnabas here in our text tonight. The devil is more than happy to start controlling good people, morally upstanding citizens, if he can just get them on the wrong track. They have the energy of wanting to be right behind them without realizing that they are doing wrong. People have no kind of understanding. That's why we have to know what is right and wrong. That's why we have to understand. second punch comes from government. It says that the Jews stirred up, quote, the chief men of the city and raised persecution against Paul and Barnabas and expelled them out of their coast. Chief men of the city is obviously the governmental officials, the local mayor, town council, if you will, in our context. What's the goal of local officials? Their goal is that, number one, keep order. Number two, to make sure that the population is protected. And that may be everything from the health laws down to the fire department, down to the police department and local law enforcement, and interaction with the county sheriffs. Well, that's what these government officials wanted here. That was number two. Number three, they want to ensure the most conducive setting for economic progress. Have you ever heard any government officials talking about the great benefits to the economy that will come as a result of them being in office? Because they know that most of their populace is motivated by money. So they want to make sure that things are stable in the city, that there's not so much crime, that businesses move out of the city, and they want to bring in new businesses and businesses that are going to really make the city grow, they're going to pay them special tax breaks in order to do that. And so business comes to the city, so we want to keep everything nice so that it will attract businesses. We want to get rid of crime, so it will attract businesses. We want to bring businesses in, we want to give some extra perks to businesses. England hasn't changed in 2,000 years. And what we have going on here is a citywide riot caused by two outside strangers. And so is it any wonder that the chief men of the city decided we need to get rid of the outside strangers? So rather than conducting a fair hearing for the outsiders, it seemed, and it is very clear from the text, that it is more prudent and it is the politically correct thing to do to get rid of Paul and Barnabas. Because they're city leaders, they have the authority to expel Paul and Barnabas. That's what they did. That was the quickest. That was the easiest way to solve their problem. Let's bring it down to modern times. As you probably notice from your own observation of our own American society, political leaders don't always do what's right. Sometimes they encourage the police force to actually violate the rights of citizens so that they can stop, for example, abortion protests. No, they want to make sure that those abortion protesters do not stand along the highway. Remember, even though that's a public forum, even though that's a place where, under law, it is permitted to stand and hold up signs. If it disturbs somebody, if it brings their city to national attention for what they don't want out there, they'll send the police out to arrest them. Most of the time, those folks spend the night in jail and then they get released the next day quietly. Paul didn't go for that, and he gets arrested in chapter 16 and thrown in prison for not breaking the law. But folks, it's the same today as it was back then. Politicians don't always do what's right. They rather do what is expedient, and they hope that it will hold so they can get back to their business He shall be brought before governors and kings for my sake for a testimony against them and the Gentiles. But when they deliver you up, take no thought how or what you shall speak, where shall they give you in that same hour, what you shall speak, where does not even speak with the Spirit of your Father, which speaketh in you. I think Paul was harkening back to the words of Jesus. He understood that he had proclaimed the word of God. There have been those who have seen. There are those who refuse, and then rejected him outright from the city. So he shook off the dust of his feet, and he headed to his next assignment. Look at Mark chapter 6. We find the same incident, but we find some additional things given to us as we turn over to the Gospel of Mark. Mark chapter 6, we'll read verses 6 through 11. And he called unto him the 12, and began to send them forth by two and two, and gave them power over unclean spirits, and commanded them that they should take nothing for their journey, save a staff only, no stick, no bread, no money, no purse. How many of you like the mission field like that? You know, they're missionaries who spend 3-4 years on deputation, trying to get enough money together just to go out on their first journey. Interesting that you went this way, wouldn't it? But he shall descend and not put on two coats. And he said unto them, in what place soever you enter into an house, there abide with you apart from that house. And whosoever shall not receive you or hear you. It's not just a matter of, hey, can I stay in your house? It's a matter of, will they hear the message that I am commissioning you to carry? That's the issue. That's the issue of Paul. And whatsoever, and whosoever shall not receive you nor hear you when you depart, shake off the dust under your feet for a testimony against them. Verily, I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city. Now we find Jesus saying it twice over the Gospel of Luke, two chapters apart. Look at Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9. And verses 1 through 5. Then he called his 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority over all devils and to cure diseases. Now, when Paul became apostle, God gave him that authority. Remember, we had a discussion all about Judas falling from his apostleship. And we had a discussion about the justice and Barsabbas having, you know, a vote taken concerning them. And then we had Paul being called as an apostle. He says so. He was called to be an apostle as one out of three times. God gave him the same authority, gave him the same power that Jesus had given to the other apostles earlier. And he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and heal the sick. And he said unto them, take nothing from your journey, neither staves nor strip, neither bread nor money, neither extra coats of peace, and whatsoever house you enter into, there abide and place depart. And whosoever will not receive you when you go out of that city, shake off the very dust from your feet for a testimony against them. And they departed and went to the town, preaching the gospel and healing everywhere. That was what authenticated the apostolic message. Let me turn over one more chapter to chapter 10. And here we look at verses 7 through 20. But into whatsoever city ye enter, and they receive you not, go your ways out into the streets of the same and say, so it's not just a matter of doing it, but saying it too. Even the very dust of your city which heaveth upon us, we do wipe off against you. Notwithstanding, be ye sure of this, that the kingdom of God is come nigh unto you. Luke gives us more information. Notwithstanding, be sure of this. Be sure of it. That the kingdom of God is come nigh unto you. But I say unto you that it shall be more tolerable in the day in that day of Sodom than in that city. Woe unto thee, Chorazin! Woe unto thee, Bethsaida! For if the mighty works have been done in Tyre and Sidon, which have been done in you, Is that a serious issue? Yes. Is it an issue we have to worry about? No. Because it's God's name that is at stake, not our personal reputation. How often we get those two feelings? How often we focus on our own personal reputation, our own personal feelings, instead of on the reputation of our Lord Jesus Christ and God's reputation, God the Father. They reject the word of Christ spoken through your lips, and you're only a messenger for them. How much sense would it be if a UPS guy showed up at your door, or a postman showed up at your door and brought you a letter of bad news? Would you beat up on the postman or the UPS guy? I certainly hope not. You see, the real problem is not with the messenger. The real problem is with the one who sent the message, and Jesus sent the message. And the 7 return again, verse 17. With joy saying, Lord, even the devil is subject unto us in thy name. And he said unto them, I beheld Satan's lightning fall from heaven. Behold, I give unto thee power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall thy enemies hurt you, notwithstanding in this rejoice not, but the spirit is subject unto you. But rather rejoice, because your names are written in heaven. You see, the 70 here, who had also been sent out, as well as the 12 earlier in chapter 9, they were so excited because, wow, we got power. Wow, look what's happening when we go out and do this. Jesus says, beating up on the enemy is not where it's at. That's not what you should be happy about. What you should be happy about is that God, in His sovereign grace, has saved you and drawn you to Himself and given you the opportunity to be able to be a witness for Him. Paul and Barnabas actually understood this. When they are there in Acts chapter 13, they shook off the dust of their feet against them and came unto Iconium. They moved on because their audience had rejected the word of the Lord. Lesson number 4 for tonight. When the word of God takes root, with true conversions following, the original leaders can leave the follow-up of the Holy Spirit without worry or fear or angst. When God's at work in place, the important thing is not the servant who was doing work in that place. The important thing is God working in that place. Is the Holy Spirit in control? Is the Holy Spirit accomplishing His purposes in full? Look what it says in verse 52. This is after Paul and Barnabas shook off the dust of their feet, verse 51, and went to Iconium. Verse 52. And the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Ghost. Now they could have been really sad. They could have said, hey, Paul and Barnabas have only been here 2 weeks. Man, that's so terrible. We're about to cut after 2 weeks. And we have such wonderful good news. And boy, couldn't they be good Bible teachers that teach us for a while. You know what? Paul got to stay in some places for a long period of time and do a lot of in-depth Bible teaching. Other places, he was in and out, like here, and he got to sit again. 2 weeks. 2 weeks. They were there on the Sabbath. They had some conversions. They came to a second Sabbath, citywide revival. Somehow during that second week, this opposition gets raised. They don't make it to the third Sabbath. They get run out of town. But the people who were saved were so energized, so excited, so thrilled with the news of grace, of salvation, rather than the law. They were so thankful for it that they took what they had for granted. We have so much more than they had. We have so much more Bible teaching, so much more doctrine. We have all the church history to look back on. We have all the great revivals that we can see that God did throughout the various centuries in different locations. We have freedom in our country. hymn number